The Outline of Science, Volume 1, by J. Arthur Thompson. Chapter 4, The Struggle for Existence, Animal and Bird Mimicry and Disguise. For every animal one discovers when observing carefully, there must be 10 unseen. This is partly because many animals burrow in the ground or get in underneath things and into dark corners, being what is called cryptozoic or elusive. But it is partly because many animals put on disguise or have in some way acquired a garment of invisibility. This is very common among animals, and it occurs in many forms and degrees. The reason why it is so common is because the struggle for existence is often very keen, and the reasons why the struggle for existence is keen are four. First, there is the tendency to overpopulation in many animals, especially those of low degree. Second, there is the fact that the scheme of nature involves nutritive chains and successive incarnations, one animal depending upon another for food, and all in the long run on plants. Thirdly, every vigorous animal is a bit of a hustler, given to insurgence and sticking out his elbows. There is a fourth great reason for the struggle for existence, namely, the frequent changefulness of the physical environment, which forces animals to answer back or die. But the first three reasons have most to do with the very common assumption of some sort of disguise. Even when an animal is in no sense a weakling, it may be very advantageous for it to be inconspicuous when it is resting, or when it is taking care of its young. Our problem is the evolution of elusiveness, so far at least as that depends on likeness to surroundings, on protective resemblance to other objects, and in its highest reaches on true mimicry. Color permanently like that of surroundings. Many animals living on sandy places have a light brown color, as is seen in some lizards and snakes. The green lizard is like the grass, and the green tree snake is inconspicuous among the branches. The spotted leopard is suited to the interrupted light of the forest, and it is sometimes hard to tell where the jungle ends and the striped tiger begins. There is no better case than the hare or the partridge sitting a few yards off on the ploughed field. Even a donkey grazing in the dusk is much more readily heard than seen. The experiment has been made of tethering the green variety of praying mantis on green herbage, fastening them with silk threads. They escape the notice of birds. The same is true when the brown variety is tethered on withered herbage. But if the green ones are put on brown plants, or the brown ones on green plants, the birds pick them off. Similarly, out of 300 chickens in a field, 240 white or black and therefore conspicuous, 60 spotted and inconspicuous, 24 were soon picked off by crows, but only one of these was spotted. This was not the proportion that there should have been if the mortality had been fortuitous. There is no doubt that it often pays an animal to be like its habitual surroundings, like a little piece of scenery if the animal is not moving. It is safe to say that in the process of time, wide departures from the safest coloration will be wiped out in the course of nature's sifting. But we must not be credulous, and there are three cautions to be borne in mind. 1. An animal may be very like its surroundings without there being any protection implied. The arrow worms in the sea are as clear as glass, and so are many open-sea animals. But this is because their tissues are so watery, with a specific gravity near that of the salt water. And the invisibility does not save them, always or often, from being swallowed by larger animals that gather the harvest of the sea. 2. Among the cleverer animals, it looks as if a creature sometimes sought out a spot where it was most inconspicuous. A spider may place itself in the middle of a little patch of lichen, where its self-effacement is complete. Perhaps it is more comfortable, as well as safer, to rest in surroundings, the general color of which is like that of the animal's body. 3. The fishes that live among the coral reefs are startling in their brilliant coloration, and there are many different patterns. To explain this, it has been suggested that these fishes are so safe among the mazy passages and endless nooks of the reefs that they can well afford to wear any color that suits their constitution. In some cases this may be true, but naturalists who have put on a diving suit and walked about among the coral have told us that each kind of fish is particularly suited to some particular place, and that some are suited for midday work and others for evening work. Sometimes there is a sort of box and cox arrangement by which two different fishes utilize the same corner at different times. Gradual change of color. The common shore crab shows many different colors and mottlings, especially when it is young. It may be green or gray, red or brown, and so forth, and it is often an admirable adjustment to the color of the rock pool where it is living. Experiments, which require extension, have shown that when the crab is molted, which it has to do very often when it is young, the color of the new shell tends to harmonize with the general color of the rocks and seaweed. How this is brought about we do not know. The color does not seem to change till the next molt, and not then unless there is some reason for it. A full-grown shore crab is well able to look after itself, and it is of interest to notice, therefore, that the variety of coloration is mainly among the small individuals, who have, of course, a much less secure position. It is possible, moreover, that the resemblance to the surroundings admits of more successful hunting, enabling the small crab to take its victim unawares. Professor Poulton's experiments with the caterpillars of the small tortoise-shell butterfly showed that in black surroundings the pupae tend to be darker, in white surroundings lighter, in gilded boxes golden, and the same is true in other cases. It appears that the surrounding color affects the caterpillars through the skin during a sensitive period, the 20 hours immediately preceding the last 12 hours of the larval state. The result will tend to make the quiescent pupae less conspicuous during the critical time of metamorphosis. The physiology of this sympathetic coloring remains obscure. Seasonal change of coloring. The ptarmigan molts 3 times in the year. Its summer plumage is rather grouse-like above, with a good deal of rufous brown. The back becomes much more gray in autumn. Almost all the feathers of the winter plumage are white. That is to say, they develop without any pigment and with numerous gas bubbles in their cells. Now there can be no doubt that this white winter plumage makes the ptarmigan very inconspicuous amidst the snow. Sometimes one comes within a few feet of the crouching bird without seeing it, and this garment of invisibility may save it from the hungry eyes of golden eagles. Similarly, the brown stoat becomes the white ermine, mainly by the growth of a new suit of white fur, and the same is true of the mountain hare. The ermine is all white except the black tip of its tail. The mountain hare in its winter dress is all white save the black tips of its ears. In some cases, especially in the mountain hare, it seems that individual hares may turn white by a loss of pigment, as may occur in man. According to Metchnikoff, the wandering amoeboid cells of the body, called phagocytes, may creep up into the hairs and come back again with microscopic burdens of pigment. The place of the pigment is taken by gas bubbles, and that is what causes the whiteness. In no animals is there any white pigment. The white color is like that of snow or foam. It is due to the complete reflection of the light from innumerable, minute surfaces of crystals or bubbles. The mountain hare may escape the fox the more readily because its whiteness makes it so inconspicuous against a background of snow. And yet, at other times, we have seen the creature standing out like a target on the dark moorland. So it cuts both ways. The ermine has almost no enemies except the gamekeeper, but its winter whiteness may help it to sneak upon its victims, such as grouse or rabbit, when there is snow upon the ground. In both cases, however, the probability is that the constitutional rhythm which leads to white hair in winter has been fostered and fixed for a reason quite apart from protection. The fact is that for a warm-blooded creature, whether bird or mammal, the physiologically best dress is a white one, for there is less radiation of the precious animal heat from white plumage or white pelage than from any other color. The quality of warm-bloodedness is a prerogative of birds and mammals, and it means that the body keeps an almost constant temperature day and night, year in and year out. This is effected by automatic internal adjustments, which regulate the supply of heat, chiefly from the muscles, to the loss of heat, chiefly through the skin, and from the lungs. The chief importance of this internal heat is that it facilitates the smooth continuance of the chemical processes on which life depends. If the temperature falls, as in hibernating mammals, whose warm-bloodedness is imperfect, the rate of this vital process is slowed down, sometimes dangerously. Thus we see how the white coat helps the life of the creature. Rapid color change. Bony flatfishes, like plaice and sole, have a remarkable power of adjusting their hue and pattern to the surrounding gravel and sand, so that it is difficult to find them even when we know that they are there. It must be admitted that they are also very quick to get a sprinkling of sand over their upturned side, so that only the eyes are left showing. But there is no doubt as to the exactness with which they often adjust themselves, to be like a little piece of the substratum on which they lie. They will do this within limits in experimental conditions when they are placed on a quite artificial floor. As these fishes are very palatable and are much sought after by such enemies as cormorants and otters, it is highly probable that their power of self-effacement often saves their life. And it may be effected within a few minutes, in some cases within a minute. In these self-effacing flatfishes, we know with some precision what happens. The adjustment of color and pattern is due to changes in the size, shape, and position of mobile pigment cells, chromatophores, and the skin. But what makes the pigment cells change? The fact that a blind flatfish does not change its color gives us the first part of the answer. The color and the pattern of the surroundings must affect the eye. The message travels by the optic nerve to the brain. From the brain, instead of passing down the spinal cord, the message travels down the chain of sympathetic ganglia. From these it passes along the nerves which comes out of the spinal cord and control the skin. Thus the message reaches the color cells in the skin, and before you have carefully read these lines, the flatfish has slipped on its Gyges ring and become invisible. The same power of rapid color change is seen in cuttlefishes, where it is often an expression of nervous excitement, though it sometimes helps to conceal. It occurs with much subtlety in the Aesop prawn, Hippolyte, which may be brown on a brown seaweed, green on sea lettuce or sea grass, red on red seaweed, and so on through an extensive repertory. According to the nature of the background, Professor Gamble writes, so is the nature of the pigments compounded so as to form a close reproduction both of its color and its pattern. A sweep of the shrimp net detaches a battalion of these sleeping prawns, and if we turn the motley into a dish and give us choice of seaweed, each variety after its kind will select the one with which it agrees in color and vanish. Both when young and when full grown, the Aesop prawn takes on the color of its immediate surroundings. At nightfall, Hippolyte, of whatever color, changes to a transparent azure blue. Its stolidity gives place to a nervous restlessness. At the least tremor, it leaps violently and often swims actively from one food plant to another. This blue fit lasts till daybreak and is then succeeded by the prawn's diurnal tint. Thus, Professor Gamble continues, the color of an animal may express a nervous rhythm. The case of chameleons. The highest level at which rapid color change occurs is among lizards, and the finest exhibition of it is among the chameleons. These quaint creatures are characteristic of Africa, but they occur also in Andalusia, Arabia, Ceylon, and southern India. They are adapted for life on trees, where they hunt insects with great deliberateness and success. The protrusible tongue, ending in a sticky club, can be shot out for about 7 inches in the common chameleon. Their hands and feet are split so that they grip the branches firmly, and the prehensile tail rivals a monkey's. When they wish, they can make themselves very slim, contracting the body from side to side, so that they are not very readily seen. In other circumstances, however, they do not practice self-effacement, but the very reverse. They inflate their bodies, having not only large lungs, but air sacs in connection with them. The throat bulges, the body sways from side to side, and the creature expresses its sentiments in a hiss. The power of color change is very remarkable and depends partly on the contraction and expansion of the color cells, chromatophores, in the underskin or dermis, and partly on close-packed refractive granules and crystals of a waste product called guanine. The repertory of possible colors in the common chameleon is greater than in any other animal except the Aesop prawn. There is a legend of a chameleon which was brown in a brown box, green in a green box, and blue in a blue box, and died when put into one line with tartan. And there is no doubt that one and the same animal has a wide range of colors. The so-called chameleon, Anolis, of North America, is so sensitive that a passing cloud makes it change its emerald hue. There is no doubt that a chameleon may make itself more inconspicuous by changing its color, being affected by the play of light on its eyes. A bright green hue is often seen on those that are sitting among strongly illumined green leaves. But the color also changes with the time of day and with the animal's moods. A sudden irritation may bring about a rapid change. In other cases, the transformation comes about very gradually. When the color change expresses the chameleon's feelings, it might be compared to a blushing, but that is due to an expansion of the arteries of the face, allowing more blood to get into the capillaries of the underskin. The case of the chameleon is peculiarly interesting because the animal has two kinds of tactics, self-effacement on the one hand and bluffing on the other. There can be little doubt that the power of color change sometimes justifies itself by driving off intruders. Dr. Cyril Crossland observed that a chameleon attacked by a fox terrier turned round and opened its great pink mouth in the face of the advancing dog, at the same time rapidly changing color, becoming almost black. This ruse succeeded every time, the dog turning off at once. In natural leafy surroundings, the startling effect would be much greater, a sudden throwing off of the mantle of invisibility and the exposure of a conspicuous black body with a large red mouth. Likenesses to other things. Dr. H. O. Forbes tells of a flat spider which presents a striking resemblance to a bird's dropping on a leaf. Years after he first found it, he was watching in a forest in the Far East when his eye fell on a leaf before him which had been blotched by a bird. He wondered idly why he had not seen for so long another specimen of the bird-dropping spider, Ornithoscatoides decipiens, and drew the leaf towards him. Instantaneously, he got a characteristic sharp nip. It was the spider after all. Here the color resemblance was enhanced by a form resemblance. But why should it profit a spider to be like a bird dropping? Perhaps because it thereby escapes attention. But there is another possibility. It seems that some butterflies, allied to our blues, are often attracted to excrementitious material, and the spider Dr. Forbes observed had actually caught its victim. This is borne out by a recent observation by Dr. D. G. H. Carpenter, who found a Uganda bug closely resembling a bird dropping on sand. The bug actually settled down on a bird dropping on sand and caught a blue butterfly which came to feed there. Some of the walking stick insects, belonging to the order of crickets and grasshoppers, Orthoptera, have their body elongated and narrow, like a thin, dry branch, and they have a way of sticking out their limbs at abrupt and diverse angles, which makes the resemblance to twigs very close indeed. Some of these quaint insects rest through the day and have the remarkable habit of putting themselves in a sort of cataleptic state. Many creatures turn stiff when they get a shock, or pass suddenly into new surroundings, like some of the sandhoppers when we lay them on the palm of our hand. But these twig insects put themselves into this strange state. The body is rocked from side to side for a short time, and then it stiffens. An advantage may be that even if they were surprised by a bird or a lizard, they will not be able to betray themselves by even a tremor. Disguise is perfected by a remarkable habit, a habit which leads us to think of a whole series of different ways of lying low and saying nothing, which are often of life-preserving value. The top end of the series is seen when a fox plays possum. The leaf butterfly Calama conspicuously colored on its upper surface, is like a withered leaf when it settles down and shows the underside of its wings. Here again there is precise form resemblance, for the nervures on the wings are like the midrib and side veins on a leaf, and the touch of perfection is given in the presence of whitish spots, which look exactly like the discolorations produced by lichens on leaves. An old entomologist, Mr. Jenner Ware, confessed that he repeatedly pruned off a caterpillar on a bush in mistake for a superfluous twig, for many brownish caterpillars fasten themselves by their posterior claspers and by an invisible thread of silk from their mouth, and project from the branch at a twig-like angle. An insect may be the very image of a sharp prickle or a piece of soft moss. A spider may look precisely like a tiny knob on a branch or a fragment of lichen. One of the seahorses, Phylloptrix, has frond-like tassels on various parts of its body, so that it looks extraordinarily like the seaweeds among which it lives. In a few cases, for instance among spiders, it has been shown that animals with a special protective resemblance to something else seek out a position where this resemblance tells, and there is urgent need for observations bearing on this selection of environment. Mimicry in the true sense. It sometimes happens that in one and the same place there are two groups of animals, not very nearly related, which are doubles of one another. Investigation shows that the members of the one group, always in the majority, are in some way specially protected, for instance, by being unpalatable. They are the mimicked. The members of the other group, always in the minority, have not got the special protection possessed by the others. They are the mimickers, though the resemblance is not, of course, associated with any conscious imitation. The theory is that the mimickers live on the reputation of the mimicked. If the mimicked are left alone by birds because they have a reputation for unpalatability, or because they are able to sting, the mimickers survive, although they are palatable and stingless. They succeed, not through any virtue of their own, but because of their resemblance to the mimicked, for whom they are mistaken. There are many cases of mimetic resemblance so striking and so subtle that it seems impossible to doubt that the thing works. There are other cases which are rather far-fetched, and may be somewhat of the nature of coincidences. Thus, although Mr. Bates tells us that he repeatedly shot hummingbird moths in mistake for hummingbirds, we cannot think that this is a good illustration of mimicry. What is needed for many cases is what is forthcoming for some, namely, experimental evidence, for instance, that the unpalatable mimicked butterflies are left in relative peace, while similar palatable butterflies are persecuted. It is also necessary to show that the mimickers do actually consort with the mimicked. Some beetles and moths are curiously wasp-like, which may be a great advantage. The common drone fly is superficially like a small bee. Some harmless snakes are very like poisonous species, and Mr. Wallace maintained that the powerful friar birds of the Far East are mimicked by the weak and timid orioles. When the model is unpalatable or repulsive or dangerous, and the mimic the reverse, the mimicry is called Batesian, after Mr. Bates, but there is another kind of mimicry called Müllerian, after Fritz Müller, where the mimic is also unpalatable. The theory in this case is that the mimicry serves as mutual assurance, the members of the ring getting on better by consistently presenting the same appearance, which has come to mean to possible enemies a signal, noli me tangere, leave me alone. There is nothing out of the question in this theory, but it requires to be taken in a critical spirit. It leads us to think of warning colors, which are the very opposite of the disguises which we are now studying. Some creatures like skunks, magpies, coral snakes, cobras, brightly colored tree frogs, are obtrusive rather than elusive, and the theory of Alfred Russel Wallace was that the flaunting conspicuousness serves as a useful advertisement, impressing itself on the memories of inexperienced enemies, who soon learn to leave creatures with warning colors alone. In any case, it is plain that an animal which is as safe as a wasp or a coral snake can afford to wear any suit of clothes it likes. Masking. The episode in Scottish history called The Walking Wood of Burnham, when the advancing troop masked their approach by cutting down branches of the trees, has had its counterpart in many countries, but it is also enacted on the seashore. There are many kinds of crabs that put on disguise with what looks like deliberateness. The sand crab takes a piece of seaweed, nibbles at the end of it, and then rubs it on the back of the carapace or on the legs so that it fixes to the bristles. As the seaweed continues to live, the crab soon has a little garden on its back, which masks the crab's real nature. It is most effective camouflaging, but if the crab continues to grow, it has to molt, and that means losing the disguise. It is then necessary to make a new one. The crab must have on the shore something corresponding to a reputation. That is to say, other animals are clearly or dimly aware that the crab is a voracious and combative creature. How useful to the crab, then, to have its appearance cloaked by a growth of innocent seaweed, or sponge, or zoophyte. It will enable the creature to sneak upon its victims, or to escape the attentions of its own enemies. If a narrow-beaked crab is cleaned artificially, it will proceed to clothe itself again. The habit has become instinctive, and it must be admitted that while a particular crab prefers a particular kind of seaweed for its dress, it will cover itself with unsuitable and even conspicuous material, such as pieces of colored cloth, if nothing better is available. The disguise differs greatly, for one crab is masked by a brightly colored and unpalatable sponge densely packed with flinty needles. Another cuts off the tunic of a sea-squirt and throws it over its shoulders. Another trundles about a bivalve shell. The facts recall the familiar case of the hermit crab, which protects its soft tail by tucking it into the empty shell of a periwinkle or a whelk or some other sea snail. And that case leads on to the elaboration known as commensalism, where the hermit crab fixes sea anemones on the back of its borrowed house. The advantage here is beyond that of masking, for the sea anemone can sting, which is a useful quality in a partner. That this second advantage may become the main one is evident in several cases where the sea anemone is borne, just like a weapon, on each of the crustacean's great claws. Moreover, as the term commensalism, eating at the same table, suggests, the partnership is mutually beneficial. For the sea anemone is carried about by the hermit crab, and it doubtless gets its share of crumbs from its partner's frequent meals. There is a very interesting sidelight on the mutual benefit in the case of a dislodged sea anemone, which sulked for a while and then waited in a state of preparedness until a hermit crab passed by and touched it, whereupon the sea anemone gripped and slowly worked itself up onto the back of the shell. Other kinds of elusiveness. There are various kinds of disguise which are not readily classified. A troop of cuttlefish swimming in the sea is a beautiful sight. They keep time with one another in their movements, and they show the same change of color almost at the same moment. They are suddenly attacked, however, by a small shark, and then comes a simultaneous discharge of sepia from their ink bags. There are clouds of ink in the clear water, for, as Professor Hickson put it, the cuttlefishes have thrown dust in the eyes of their enemies. One can see a newborn cuttlefish do this a minute after it escapes from the egg. Very beautiful is the way in which many birds, like our common chaffinch, disguise the outside of their nest with moss and lichen and other trifles felted together, so that the cradle is as inconspicuous as possible. There seems to be a touch of art in fastening pieces of spider's web on the outside of a nest. How curious is the case of the tree sloth of South American forests that walks slowly, back downwards, along the undersides of the branches, hanging on by its long curved fingers and toes. It is a nocturnal animal, and therefore not in special danger, but when resting during the day it is almost invisible, because its shaggy hair is so like certain lichens and other growths on the branches. But the protective resemblance is enhanced by the presence of a green alga, which actually lives on the surface of the sloth's hairs, an alga like the one that makes tree stems and gateposts green in damp weather. There was no commoner sight in the early summer than the cuckoo spit on the grasses and herbage by the wayside. It is conspicuous, and yet it is said to be left severely alone by almost all creatures. In some way it must be a disguise. It is a sort of soap made by the activity of small frog-hoppers while they are still in the wingless larval state, before they begin to hop. The insect pierces with its sharp mouth-parts the skin of the plant and sucks in sweet sap, which by and by overflows over its body. It works its body up and down many times, whipping in air, which mixes with the sugary sap, reminding one of how whipped egg is made. But along with the sugary sap in the air, there is a little ferment from the food canal and a little wax from glands on the skin, and the four things mixed together make a kind of soup, which lasts through the heat of the day. There are many other modes of disguise besides those that we have been able to illustrate. Indeed, the biggest fact is that there are so many, for it brings us back to the idea that life is not an easy business. It is true, as Walt Whitman says, that animals do not sweat and whine about their condition. Perhaps it is true, as he says, that not one is unhappy over the whole earth. But there is another truth, that this world is not a place for the unlit lamp and the ungirt loin, and that when a creature has not armor or weapons or cleverness, it must find some path of safety or go back. One of these paths of safety is disguise, and we have illustrated its evolution. End of chapter.